All right, welcome everyone. This week's Torah reading, B'Shalach, is the story of the crossing of the Sea of Reeds and the famous song of the sea. But there are actually two songs of the sea, and that's going to be our focus. The question, the big question I want to ask is, why are there two songs of the sea? Why isn't one song enough?
Oh, that's nice.
Okay.
I'll raise my hand. You ready for an answer?
Yeah.
Well, if you accept the arguments that we had two parshas ago about the midwives being Jews, Hebrews, then you got to say, well, Hashem wants to give women an explicit chance to participate in the miracle because out of merit for what they did for all Hebrew women.
Okay, so let's look at the verses. They cross the Sea of Reed and Moshe leads them in a song.
Well, there's an echo.
Could everybody?
Yeah, there's an echo. Unless you're talking.
Yeah. Okay, hold on. Let's see here. I can do this. I muted everybody. If you want to talk, then unmute yourself. So there is a long song called Shiraz Hayam that found itself into our liturgy. We say it every day in the morning prayer in Shacharit. We say it on Shabbat morning, but we say it also on weekday mornings. It's 18 verses from chapter 15, verse 1, all the way to verse 18, ending with Adonai Yimloch Le'olam Va'ed. But that's not enough. Then, oh, and here's how it starts. Az Yashir Moshe Ubnei Israel. Then sang Moshe and the children of Israel this song to Adonai, uttered this utterance. I will sing to Adonai, for he has triumphed, yes, triumphed. The horse and its charioteer he flung into the sea, etc., etc., for 18 verses. But apparently, that's not enough, because right after that, we hear about another song, much shorter. And the verse tells us, ותיקח מרים הנביאה אחות אהרון את התוף בידה ותצא לכל אנשים אחריה בתופים ובמחולות. So Miriam, the prophetess, she's introduced to us as prophetess, and that she's a sister of Aaron. She took the tof. Now in modern Hebrew, tof means drum. So Miriam took the drum, but it's often translated, we'll see, as timbrel or tambourine. And then all the women went after her, came after her, dancing with drums and dancing. And then she sang this verse. This is her only verse. Shiru Adonai ki ga'o ga'as usve'ochvo rama v'yam. And in English? You have it here in English. So, first of all, just on a linguistic note about the instrument that she used. It's called Tof Miriam. Now, in this English translation from, I think this is Professor Everett Fox's timbrel, you wouldn't know that Miriam coined this term. But in modern Hebrew, I want to show you what Tof Miriam is. You see? Tof Miriam, tambourine. To this day, a tambourine in Hebrew is called Tof Miriam. So I don't know the differences between timbrel, tambourine, or Miriam's drum. But this she has the privilege of having a modern day musical instrument named after her. And when I came first to the States, I used to say to people, you know, when I was little, we had classes in the conservatory and we had Miriam's drum. Nobody knew what I'm talking about because I was translating Tof Miriam, Miriam's drum. But today we use the word tambourine. So that's just a note about the instrument that she used. Okay, so she used the instrument and...
Tamar, can I ask a question?
Yeah.
So maybe you're going to get to this, but the question I would have is, why is she called Aaron's son and not a sister and not Moshe's sister?
Oh, that's an excellent question. We're going to ask that, yes.
Okay.
So... All right, so here are the questions. Do you see three questions on the screen? Or no? Why do we need another song? Didn't the first one include everyone? So Bill said about the honoring the women, but it seems to me from the verse, the earlier verse, that everyone was included in the first one. Again, let's go back. Then sang Moshe the children of Israel. The children of Israel always includes women. I mean, look at the whole parsha last week about the children of Israel, the Exodus. It wasn't just the men. It was clearly all of Israel. So when it says, "As Yashir Moshe Ubnei Israel," the pshat is that includes both men and women. Now, we're going to see in a second. Our commentaries felt the difficulty here. So they actually did say what Bill is saying, that Moses led the men and Miriam led the women. I don't see that it fits into the pshat, the basic, simple meaning of the verse, because the Torah does know how to tell us when it's only men. And the first song, the long one, the Torah doesn't say men. The Torah says Moshe and the children of Israel. Okay, so that's question number one. Then question number two, why is he introduced as a prophetess? We don't read anywhere, at least until now, that she's a prophet in the classic sense of the word, that she had a vision with God and God spoke to her. So what is this? Why is she being called a prophetess? Until now, God only spoke to Moses and Aaron. So what does that mean? Is there a different meaning to prophetess? Maybe we need to expand the definition of the word prophetess, Neviah. And then Aaron's question, which was, why is she introduced as Aaron's sister? Isn't she also Moshe's sister? And finally, why is her song so short? Why is it just one verse? Were they in a hurry to get to the Kiddush? Okay, so let's tackle the last one. Look how similar it is. She chanted, "Sing to Adonai, for he has triumphed the horse and its charioteer, he has flung into the sea." And then Moshe, also, this is Moshe's song. "I will sing to Adonai, for he has triumphed. So maybe it's just a repeat of the first verse, and then etc. So that is the opinion of one of our commentators, Chizkuni. He says, she actually said the whole song again, but the Torah is not going to repeat the whole 18 verses. So the Torah is giving you the first verse, and it's the Torah's way of saying, etc. So it's not just one verse. But again, it's difficult because the Torah could have said she said the same song or some other way of saying she repeated the song. The Torah just gives us this verse. Okay? The Torah just says, Vatalahe Miriam. Miriam said to the women. And then there's the verse. Shiru Adonai ki ga'ahu ha'asus b'chol ha'mayam. That's it. And that's where it ends. Perhaps she only did say only this verse. Then why is it so short? Why was it sufficient for her song to be comprised of only one verse? Okay. So those are the questions. So back to the idea that she's saying to the women and Moshe saying to the men, that's actually a midrash that is quoted by Rashi. So Moses sang the song to the men, he sang it and they repeated it after him. And Miriam sang the song to the women and they repeated it after her. Now let's fact check Rashi. So we just had actually a story where somebody said, I want only the men to go out of Egypt. Who said that?
Pharaoh.
Right. Pharaoh said to the men, to Moses, and so the Torah knows how to say when it's only men. I want to show you the verse. And clearly the Torah doesn't use that term here. So and in the plague of the locust, Pharaoh almost yielded, almost yielded to let the Israelites go, and then he said the following: Lochen lechuna hagvarim v'ivdu et Adonai. No, you gentlemen, only men, go and worship Adonai. So we have a way to differentiate between the entire people of Israel and only the men. And this is the word, gvarim. Okay, so we just had that differentiation. So if that were the case, if Rashi is correct, then we would expect this same phrase to appear in Moshe's Song of the Sea. He would lead the gvarim, right? Moshe sang to the gvarim, and Miriam saying to the Nashim, but that's not what it says. If we scroll forward, we see that when we get to the song of Moshe, it's Bnei Israel. Just to show you again. Az Yashir Moshe, Uvnei Israel. This seems to suggest the entire people of Israel, not just the men. So that's one difficulty with Rashi's explanation. Another difficulty is that it almost seems like Rashi is influenced by the Orthodox synagogue and the Mechitza. That's the only thing missing from his commentary. Okay, and where was the Mechitza? Okay, there it is. Right? I just put it. I added it to him. But in the Bible, people sang together. Men and women sang together. How do we know that? Because in the Haftarah that we're going to read on Shabbat morning, there was a Deborah song. We read about the judge, Deborah. She was a prophetess. She's actually introduced as a prophetess. And then the Bible tells us, on that day, Deborah and Barak ben Abinoam sang. And then there's a whole long song. So I just gave you the first verse here. So there's no problem of men and women singing together. Okay, so maybe Middle Ages, commentaries are already so used to the Mechitza, they're like inserting it into the Tanakh. But in Tanakh, there was no need for Deborah to sing only to the women. She sang with Barak and with the entire people of Israel in her time. So why would you say that Moshe only sang to the men, Miriam only sang to the men? That's kind of foreign. There was no need for that, clearly, in a later song. Again, a song of victory after a important victory over our enemies. So that's the second difficulty with Rashi's explanation, which is a classic explanation that adopted by so many. And now I said that her song is very similar to Moshe's song, that verse, Shirul Adonai Ki Ga'oga. But let's fact check that. I want to show you and ask you to notice there is a small difference that may be not so small. So compare Moshe's first line to Miriam's entire song. And the blue, do you see the I hope you're seeing the slides. If you're not, let me know.
See it. We don't see it.
So what is the difference? It seems like almost the same.
I don't see any slides.
No
slides. Slide.
Oh. Okay, sorry. Now? Okay.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Yes, okay, now.
So I want you to look at it. In a quick glance, you might say, oh, it's the same. But there is a difference. What is it?
Word.
Yeah, which word?
Rishvo and Rama. Did you hear?
Rishvo and Rama. Rama, what? Rama is the same.
Okay, so, you're right. No, never mind.
The first word is different.
Right. So look at the first word.
Ashira.
Okay. Moses saying Ashira Adonai. She's saying Shirul Adonai. You might think, oh, it's just some minor grammatical difference. It's not so minor. Let's see it in English. What's the difference between Ashira and Shiru? Other than that, it is the same. All the words are the same. Here it is in English. Moses saying, I will sing. That's Ashira. She's saying, Miriam, you, plural, sing to Adonai. So she is actually talking to them and saying, you, all the women around me, I want you to sing. Whereas Moshe was only about himself. In other words, the first, the Torah, the narrator says, he's saying it with the children of Israel. But when we listen to his words, he's only talking about himself. And of course, there's no music, no instruments in his song, no dancing. So now we're getting to see his song maybe in a different light. Maybe his song is more of the prophet's song, the elitist song, not elitist, but the spiritual leader's song, who is such at a high level that he thinks about, he's talking about himself. He doesn't need any instruments. He doesn't want dancing. But then Miriam comes along and says, wait, no, that's not good enough. I want the public to participate. So I'm going to change that first word. I like your verses. So I'm going to copy the verse. I'm not going to make up my own words. So I have no argument with the words, with the content. But I have a problem with how you're choreographing this, as if this is your own song, because you are the spiritual leader and you are on such a high level. I don't want it to be that way. I want everybody to participate. So Shirul Adonai, everybody sing, and I'm going to add timbrels, or if you want, tambourines, and I'm going to add dancing, and let everybody feel this is their own song. This is not just a song of the leader.
Shammai, but Mary, the way it's phrased, Miriam is setting herself up as a leader at this point, not necessarily a spiritual leader, but she's giving a command the way that it's phrased, rather than what Moshe is doing.
Oh, that's interesting that you're seeing it as a command, whereas Moshe is just saying, just follow my example. Okay. I
see Moshe's song as more of a prayer of thanksgiving that he is giving to God, since he is the leader of the Hebrews. He is thanking God for the triumph. She is thanking, but in a more inclusive way.
Yeah. So I also think that her song is more inclusive, and in fact, I want to call it that she democratized the Moshe's song. How? She conjugates the verb sing. Instead of I will sing, everybody sing. She shortens it. And I think that's part of it. She says maybe the spiritual leader, the prophet, can go on and on and on. I think most people, their attention span is short. So let them just say one verse and repeat that verse, dance to it, add music, add the timbrels, add the hora or whatever dance they danced. Let's make it something that everybody can participate. Not everybody can say 18 verses and focus on their meaning. Okay? Moshe, you can do that. Of course, you are on a very high spiritual level. But I think we need to democratize the song. This is what we would say today. Make it, as Joan says, make it more inclusive. And that explains all her changes. I think it's a interesting way to summarize basically all the changes she inserts into, and I'm taking the position that that was the only verse she said, that it's not, etc. And it's on purpose, because as we know, you know, some people, they can't, you know, participate in a 3-hour long davening. They, you know, the davening needs to be shorter for them. And she finds that, and she says, okay, as long as they participate, as long as they say that one verse, then we have achieved our goal of making it inclusive, making everybody participate. Okay.
I think that Miriam encourages women to sing. She doesn't command them, just encourage them.
Right. So I agree that the shiru is more of a encourage. Right. So it's the difference between command and just regular inviting. This is really how you tell people to do things. Oh, you know what? In Hebrew grammar, it's called do the future. Anytime you ask people to do something, you're using a certain tense, and this is the way it would be. So yeah, I don't think that she's really commanding them, but more of a invitation. Yeah. Okay.
So why then do we go back to your question about why is she being called a prophetess?
Because our
idea of prophetess is not somebody who foretells the future. It's somebody who leads.
Okay. So here we're going to go to a great question. The Chizkuni, who lived in 13th century France, yes, and said about this word. So maybe do I have a volunteer to read the Chizkuni?
Miriam Hanevia. The word prophetess is used here to describe Miriam's extraordinary ability to use words to express her feelings.
Keep going.
According to Vashbam, the word is also used as describing someone who preaches to people to behave morally and ethically correctly. Compare when God told Moses that his brother Aaron would be Nevi'echa, which could hardly mean your prophet, as Moses outclassed him in that department.
So earlier in the Exodus story, I like this comment by Chizkuni, God says to him, your brother Aaron, Yehiyeh Nevi'echa, will be your prophet. But in the context there, it means that he's going to be do the speaking to Pharaoh, right? You, Moses, you complain that you are stuttering, you can't be, you know, you use words properly. Well, I'll send Aaron to be your Nevi'echa. So it's not in the terms of having visions with God and communicating with God. More, it's more about like what. So he's using this as an example where Navi doesn't necessarily mean somebody who had a vision with God. And so, yeah, we haven't heard about Miriam having a vision, but she definitely was expressing her feelings of praise to God, of this was a great miracle, of wanting everybody to participate in thanking God. And that earns her the title, the honorific prophetess. So very interesting.
Shammai?
Yeah.
Is it possible that Miriam repeats the song for the same reason that Aaron does the speaking, so that that verse can be amplified in a way that the people understand better, simply because he has a list?
Ah. Oh, very interesting. Yeah, that's definitely... And that would tie it in to just as Aharon was called Navi when he was used as basically somebody amplifying Moshe's message, which could have been ambiguous since he had the speech defect. So too here, she's amplifying her brother's message of thanks, of song, so that everybody can understand it. Very, very interesting.
And maybe that fits in with the thing that she's called Aaron's sister, because Aaron is the prophet vis-a-vis speaking for Moses. Here, Miriam is speaking for Aaron, who is she's speaking for Aaron, or in lieu of Aaron, as being Moshe's mouthpiece.
As a mouthpiece. Very interesting. Very, very, very interesting reading of the word Nevi'ah, Miriam Nevi'ah. She's a prophetess in the sense that, yeah, she's speaking for Moshe and making his song accessible to everybody, because it is very logical that maybe they didn't even understand his words. If you know, if the people in Egypt couldn't understand it, he needed a, so to speak, interpreter, you know, with having Aaron, then that hasn't gone away, presumably. He still has that difficulty. And so now Miriam is rose to the occasion and said, okay, I'll be your mouthpiece. Very, very, I like that.
Yeah. I think that's nice, but I'm respectfully disagree, because all of Deuteronomy is Moses speaking. And if people couldn't understand what he was saying, then what's the whole point? I think that with Miriam, she took the first words as a chorus, and she, the most meaningful, most important part of the prayer, I'm saying that that was really a prayer of thanksgiving that Moses did, and she took the chorus of it and she gave it her all, and the women, I don't know why they brought their tambourines with them when we're in Florida right now, and I can tell you I didn't bring anything like a tambourine. Who would have thought you'd need a tambourine? Yeah. So she took the chorus and the women responded.
Yeah. So so to answer your question, Moses had 40 years to practice by the time he got to Deuteronomy. So maybe he got better. It's a possibility. And it's nice hearing different interpretations that you guys have. I want to end with a midrash that says, actually, Miriam did have a vision in Egypt. The rabbis in the midrash are very troubled that she says she would not, see, they don't like the Chizkuni's approach. No, if the Torah calls her Neviah, prophet, she had some vision. Okay, so what's that vision? There's nothing in the text. So they come and add a very colorful midrash. Let's hear Rabbi Forman describe that midrash, because it's just very, it's very colorful. It's very, it's worth just listening to that midrash, and you'll get a whole different approach. That, again, it's not in the text, but it's very, very interesting. So I'm going to invite Rabbi Forman.
Chazal also wonder about Miriam's song. They wonder about how she's introduced, how the Torah introduces her to us just before she sings it. Vatikach Miriam Hanavia Achot Aaron et Atov Piada. The language of the verse is that Miriam the prophetess, the sister of Aaron, took the timbrels in her hands, and then she sang the song. But listen to that introduction. And Miriam the prophetess, the sister of Aaron. We know two things about her, that she was a prophet, and that she was the sister of Aaron. But why do we need to know those things? Why does Miriam, being a prophetess, uniquely qualify her to sing this song? And what do you mean that she was the sister of Aaron? She was the sister of both Aaron and Moshe. Chazal say a fascinating thing. They say if you want to understand why Miriam sang this song, you need to understand two things. A, that she was a prophetess, and B, that she had a prophecy when she was just the sister of Aaron and not yet the sister of Moshe, because Moshe had not yet been born. Indeed, it was a prophecy about the birth of Moshe. If you understand that prophecy, you'll understand the song. And here's the story they tell. When Paro had decreed that all Jewish male children should be thrown into the Nile immediately after birth, the man and woman who would become the parents of Moshe separated from each other and didn't want to have any more children. Why bother? The child's just going to die anyway. But Miriam, their daughter, had a prophecy. That prophecy was, my mother is going to give birth to the savior of the Jewish people. And she told that prophecy to her parents, and her parents reunited. And now, picking up from chapter 2 in Exodus, verse 2, Vatara isha vatelet bein, and the woman conceived and gave birth to a child, Vatera Oto Kitov, and she saw that the child was good. Of course, the first time we hear those words, Kitov, in the Torah, it's when God made light and saw the light was good. So the sages say here too, when she saw that the child was Kitov, a miraculous light filled the room to signify the birth of a special child. Chazal say that when the light filled the room, Miriam's parents came and kissed her and said, Biti, our daughter, nitkaiman devuateich. Your prophecy evidently has been fulfilled. But it's never that simple. Batitzbeneu shlosha yirachim. the mother of the child then hid the child for 3 full months. V'lo yachla od hatzpina, but she couldn't continue hiding the child. The child's cries would be heard. Pharaoh's troops were everywhere, looking for Jewish children to kill. And at that moment, v'tikach lo tevat gomer, she took a pitiful little box, v'tachmereh b'chemer u'b'zefet, and she slathered it with pitch, v'tasim ba dayelet, and she placed the child in the box, v'tasim b'suf al svat ha'yor, and she placed the child in the reeds next to the shore of the river. Now, if you were the mother of the child at that time, what would you give the chances of success of this plan of yours? You're going to put this defenseless child out there by the Nile, where all the Egyptians are. Pharaoh has decreed that all Jewish baby boys should be thrown in the Nile. What are the chances that this child lives? Now, let me ask you another question. Could you watch what happens next? Most of us couldn't watch, but someone watched. The next words of the verse, Vatetatsev achoto merachok, ladea maya aselo. But his sister, Miriam, stood from afar to see what would be with him. Chazal say she wanted to know what would be with her prophecy. Now, if you stopped Miriam and you asked her, explain to me, how is this going to happen? How do you think this child could possibly live? What would Miriam say? Miriam doesn't know, but what she does know is this. Just because I can't figure it out doesn't mean there's no way this child can be saved. God has ways. And look at the next verse. Vatered bat paro lirchotz al hayor. The daughter of Paro comes. Stop right there. If you don't know what happens next, is the daughter of Pharaoh coming good news or bad news? I mean, this is the worst possible person who could come. The daughter of the man who decreed genocide upon the Jews, killing every Jewish male. But of course, the daughter of Pharaoh becomes the savior. So Miriam, reading the uncertainty in her eyes, says, can I call a Jewish woman to nurse this child for you? And the daughter of Paro says yes. And Miriam, standing from afar, watching to see what sort of miracle God could perform, actually becomes the agent of salvation itself. Listen to those words, Vatetatsev achoto merachok ladea maya aselo. And she stood from afar to see what would be with him. And she stood from afar, Vatetatsev achoto merachok. Where else do we hear words like that? Fast forward to the Jews at the Sea of Reeds. Picture the scene. There's a huge body of water, and the dominant natural feature is reeds. And their horses belonging to Pharaoh, chariots, cavalry with soldiers, all converging upon the people. It's like it's all happening again. One Jew, Moshe, was threatened by one Egyptian, the daughter of Pharaoh, by a river while he was in the reeds. And now it's not just a river, it's a whole sea. And it's not just a couple bulrushes, it's a whole sea of reeds. And now it's not just one Jew that's threatened, it's an entire Jewish people that's threatened, and not just threatened by one particular Egyptian, but by the whole army of Egypt. And what does Moshe say? Vayomer Moshe Ela'am, Moshe says to the people, Al tira'u, don't be afraid. Hityatzvu uru'u et Yeshuat Hashem. Stand and watch the salvation that God will perform. It's the same words. It's exactly what Miriam did. How are you going to get out of this? Moshe says to the people. You're going to do exactly what Miriam did. It's just a replay of my experience with Miriam at the national level. If we're going to get out of this alive, you need to do what Miriam did. Stand and watch. Moshe does not tell them what's going to happen. They do not know the sea is going to split. It is a test of their faith. The question is, can you be like Miriam? Miriam didn't know how the salvation was going to come about. All she knew is that she had a promise that it would. And when doom seemed certain, she didn't avert her eyes. She stood and watched. Moshe is asking the same thing of the Jews right now. Doom seems certain, but you have a promise from God. It's going to be okay. So stand and watch too.
Okay. So very interesting explanation. Miriam symbolizes this stand and watch approach. And just like she did in Egypt, and back when Moses was born, and now she's the one who gets to sing the song. And this all ties back to her prophecy that she had back in Egypt, you know, telling her parents, don't separate, keep living as husband and wife, have children, because, you know, God has prophesied to me that the leader of Israel, the one who, so very interesting explanation. So I think we'll end with that. Thanks all for joining. I don't agree particularly with
service.
Yeah, I the stand and watch part, I'm not sure, because she actually took action. To me, Miriam symbolizes the take action and hope that God will help. To me, right? If you look at all her actions, it's not, I'm just going to, right? It's like, if you think about all the Holocaust survivors, almost every single one of them did whatever they could to survive. Now, some people did and it didn't help them. But if you go to every one of them, they did whatever they could, talking to their Gentile neighbors, hiding in places that you would never think, right? They took action. So to me, Miriam actually doesn't symbolize the stand and watch, but the take action and complement that with belief in God. That's how I see her.
Rabbi Foreman's also making, and I think the world of his stuff, but he makes a presupposition about Pharaoh's daughter. That she is an immediate threat. I mean, we can assume, you know, from that her presence may be a threat, but she not necessarily. And the fact is, if all the Jewish children were being thrown in the river at that point, why would Pharaoh's daughter want to be bathing there? You know, so she may have had the text does not tell us that she was a threat. It's pretty much just the opposite.
Yeah. All right. So I guess we can continue discussing this, but I think it's time for Marv. And thank you for somebody who commented here about also the Israelites at the sea. God told them to take action. They sound, move forward. It's not just about waiting, you know, waiting on the sidelines and hoping that God will intervene. It's almost like a theological argument that we're having here. You know, should you just believe God will help, or should you do everything possible in your own power to get yourself out of a situation that's trouble? You know, how to read the verses, how to interpret the actions that the biblical figures took. All right, so
thank you, Shammai. That was very interesting.
Thank you.
Okay,
Shammai, excellent.
All right,
you taught me how to read differently.